Books on Tape presents Joseph Smith by Robert V. Remini, read by Del Roy. Preface. Since its founding in the town of Fayette, Seneca County, New York, nearly two centuries ago, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, LDS, has become a worldwide religion. More commonly known as the Mormon Church, it claims about 11 million members, and its branches are located throughout the United States, Europe, South America, South Africa, Japan, Korea, the Pacific Islands, New Zealand, and Australia. Its assets, according to some non-Mormon sources, exceed $20 billion, and its annual income is estimated at more than $5 billion. Its organization, operation, and fundamental beliefs are the same in the Pacific Islands as they are in Salt Lake City, the headquarters of the church, and its membership and assets keep mounting each year. The founder of this church, the prophet Joseph Smith, Jr., is unquestionably the most important reformer and innovator in American religious history, and he needs to be understood if we want to have a clearer idea about what this country was like in the Jacksonian era, just prior to the Civil War. Because he made such an enduring contribution to American life and culture, and because he was influenced by the intellectual milieu and events of his time, I have made a special effort in this book to show the extent to which he and his work reflect the unique characteristics of this extraordinary age. Furthermore, I want to explain many of the factors that account for the ultimate success of Mormonism, despite unrelenting persecution, and what it was about this religion that elicited both savage hatred by some and undying devotion by others. And of course, I wish to make available to the general reader the basic tenets of the Mormon religion, showing where it parallels and where it sharply diverges from other Christian faiths. I should make it clear at the outset that I am not a Mormon. As such, I faced several problems in writing this book, one of which involved Joseph's visions and revelations, which are crucial to an understanding of him, his church, and the times in which he lived. After considerable thought, I decided to present his religious experiences just as he described them in his writings, and let readers decide for themselves to what extent they would give credence to them. I am not out to prove or disprove any of his claims. As a historian, I have tried to be as objective as possible in narrating his life and work. Mormons will have no problem in believing everything Joseph related about his encounters with the divine. Others may be skeptical, but I hope they will, like me, find his life and legacy of particular importance in better appreciating how this nation developed during the early 19th century, and how religion played such a commanding role in that process. To put it another way, Joseph Smith is the religious figure in United States history who has had the largest following, and that is true, I think, because so much of what he believed and taught resulted from the social, political, and intellectual dynamism of the Jacksonian age. Moreover, since a good deal of the documentary evidence about this religion, its origins, and its history comes directly from Mormons, readers will also have to decide for themselves whether or not they are willing to believe what the believers themselves report. And it must be remembered that, to a large extent, many of these sources were intended to validate Joseph's claims, strengthen the faith of his followers, and attract the interest of non-believers. Another problem I faced in writing this book was getting to know Joseph Smith intimately. In the past, I have studied and written extensively on the Jacksonian era, and several of my books discuss the religious reforms of the antebellum period, which necessarily include the life and work of the prophet. Still, I had never studied the man up close. The subjects of my several biographies have been political leaders. Smith was a different breed altogether. I dare say the problem of writing on any religious figure, Christian, Jew, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, whatever, is difficult, because believers see the person as somewhat sacred, and non-believers see him or her as strange or fake. So I had much research to do to learn all the details of Smith's life and what made him a unique individual. In this regard, I was fortunate to know Lee Groberg, who started me off by sending me a copy of the videotape and script for his film American Prophet, The Story of Joseph Smith, which appeared on PBS along with Heidi S. Swinton's excellently written and lavishly illustrated book of the same title. Professionally, I was assisted enormously by Professor Richard Lyman Bushman of Columbia University, a Mormon, who provided me with several of his articles, answered some of the toughest questions I had about Joseph's teaching, and helped me become acquainted with a number of scholars at Brigham Young University, BYU, particularly those of the Joseph Fielding Smith Institute for the Study of the Church of Latter-day Saints. As a result, I was invited to lecture at BYU, where I met and conducted a seminar with members of the History, Philosophy, and Religion departments. They subsequently inundated me with books, articles, and doctoral dissertations about their religion and its history, for which I am most grateful. Among the men and women of that university to whom I owe a particular debt, I want to single out first and foremost Scott H. Fallring of the Smith Institute, who not only answered many of my questions about the Mormon Church via email, but out of his kindness and generosity, presented me with copies of Smith's 7-volume History of the Church, 2 volumes of selections from the Encyclopedia of Mormonism, his own edition of An American Prophet's Record, The Diaries and Journals of Joseph Smith, and the complete Encyclopedia of Mormonism on a CD-ROM. To me, he is the embodiment of Mormon virtues. Ronald K. Esplin, director of the Smith Institute, gave me several boxes of valuable documentary material, including the papers of Joseph Smith, edited by Dean C. Jesse. In addition, he sent along his doctoral dissertation on the emergence of Brigham Young's Mormon leadership following Smith's assassination. William C. Hartley also provided me with several copies of his articles that had been published in various Mormon journals. And Grant Underwood gave me a copy of his The Millenarian World of Early Mormonism, and arranged for my visit to BYU. I owe a particular debt to John W. Welch, law professor at BYU, and editor-in-chief of BYU Studies, who kindly read selected pages of my manuscript and offered suggestions to help clarify certain areas of Mormon belief. I am most grateful to all the members of the BYU faculty for their interest and assistance. When I set out to write this book, I went to the local LDS chapel in my neighborhood and asked to purchase copies of the Book of Mormon, the Pearl of Great Price, and Doctrine and Covenants, the 3 basic documents of the Mormon faith, but was told there were none for sale. A week or two later, Lynn Johnson, a patriarch of the church, came to my house and formally presented me with a handsomely bound volume containing all 3 titles. I am most obliged to him and to the local ward for their generosity. Before beginning this narrative, I want to make it very explicit that although these men helped me enormously with some of the factual data contained in this book, they in no way influenced my interpretation of the prophet. None of them volunteered information. They simply responded to my questions and requests. The interpretation here is completely my own. Still, I want them to know how truly grateful I am for their willingness to cooperate in my efforts to treat the prophet fairly and without prejudice. Joseph Smith, Jr. deserves a respectful hearing, and I hope neither he nor the saints at BYU and around the globe will be disappointed or offended by what is written here. Robert V. Remini, Wilmette, Illinois. Chapter 1, The Second Great Awakening. Joseph Smith, Jr. was born into a wildfire of religious frenzy that raged over large parts of the United States in the early 19th century and influenced virtually every aspect of American life and thought. Called the Second Great Awakening, the first occurred in the middle of the 18th century, this explosive force swept with such scalding ferocity through western New York that the region came to be known as the Burned Over District. It marked the beginning of a new and vigorous evangelical movement that started with a series of revival meetings at the turn of the century and reached its zenith in the 1820s and 1830s, the years Joseph Smith, Jr. was born and raised and grew to maturity. The countryside was engulfed by the fires of repeated revivals in which itinerant preachers of little education but mesmerizing oratory summoned sinners to repent and reform their lives. Emotional orgies resulted, reaching such heights that they generated wild scenes of men and women weeping and tearing their hair, vocally confessing their sins, beating their breasts, rolling on the ground, crawling on all fours like dogs, and barking at trees where they had presumably cornered the devil. Some of these preachers were given names by their detractors that were meant to match their antics, names such as Jumpin' Jesus, or Crazy Dow, or Mad Isaac. Mrs. Frances Trollope visited the United States in 1827, stayed 3.5 years, and wrote a critical book published in 1832 called The Domestic Manners of Americans. She witnessed one of these camp meetings, and what she saw frightened her half to death. "These people behaved like lunatics," she exclaimed. "One minute they seemed sane, the next raving mad." She fled the scene in panic and disbelief. Many reasons explain this religious phenomenon. Americans at the time were undergoing sudden, jolting change again and again. In fact, the United States changed more profoundly in the 30 years from 1790 to 1820 than during any other period in its history. As a starter, Americans had just concluded a revolution in which they shucked off monarchical rule for a wholly untried governmental system. They established a republic first under the Articles of Confederation, which failed, and then under the Constitution. Shortly thereafter, they formed political parties to run the government. But this experiment in freedom, as it was called, met only contempt and disdain from European heads of state. France wanted to bribe the XYZ affair before recognizing American ambassadors. It also seized American ships in French ports and engaged in naval combat with U.S. vessels, precipitating the quasi-war with France in 1797-1798, which President John Adams managed to prevent from escalating into a full-fledged war. And England was worse. It refused to abandon its forts on U.S. soil, as required under the peace treaty that ended the Revolution. It armed Indians and encouraged them to attack the frontier. It seized American ships. It impressed seamen. And it issued orders in council that virtually stifled U.S. international trade. Exasperated, the nation declared war against Great Britain in 1812. This is sometimes called the Second War of Independence, only to have its coastline blockaded, Washington captured, and the White House and Capitol burned. During the war, one disaster followed another. Not until General Andrew Jackson won a spectacular victory at New Orleans on January 8, 1815, was the nation rescued from the disgrace of utter and complete military defeat. Jackson's victory, in which more than 2,000 professional British soldiers were killed, wounded, or captured by a ragtag collection of American militiamen, regulars, men of color, Indians, pirates, and townspeople, set in motion a nationalistic surge. Americans reveled in the firm knowledge that they had finally accomplished real recognition of their nation's independence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.